Hello and welcome to the 21st session of the virtual Bible study. And this evening we will study from Daniel chapter 9 verse 19 following about the 70 weeks introductory part. Let me first take the study, and then at the end of the study session we will have the discussions, Q&A, interactions and clarifications. Let us pray. Father, we thank and praise you for this evening, and we thank you for enabling us to come together to study your word. Keep us away from distractions and help us to value the revelation of your word in all its majesty. Give us, Lord, in-depth understanding of your word and the ability to grasp its mystery. Open our souls to receive your seed, that we may be fruitful as a result of this evening's study. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship the Lord by singing this very familiar chorus, "There is none like you." Good evening, and it's once again a pleasure to have you for the virtual Bible study session 21. And without doubt, God will underscore his words and his purposes for us through the study tonight. Today we will study from Daniel 9 and verse 20 to 27. And the subject is the mysterious truth of the 70 weeks. And this is part 1 in the series. Let me read to you Daniel chapter 9 verse 20 to 27, and you could follow the screen and pay attention in your Bibles as well. Daniel chapter 9, beginning to read from verse 20. It says, "While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and making my requests to the Lord my God for his holy hill, while I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice. He instructed me and said to me, 'Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. As soon as you began to pray, an answer was given, which I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed. Therefore, consider the message and understand the vision. 70 sevens are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the Most Holy. Know and understand this, from the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the Anointed One, the ruler, comes, there will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. It will be rebuilt with streets and a trench, but in times of trouble. After the 62 sevens, the Anointed One will be cut off and will have nothing. The people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end, and desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the 7, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering. And on a wing of the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. Please take notes and jot down your questions if there be, and we will discuss them once we are through with the study tonight. Now, in today's study, we get an overview of the prophecy of the 70 weeks. And I'm going to do a two-part series on this passage. So today would be more of an introduction to this passage, and this will help us to have a grip over the prophecy here. And next week, we will get into the prophetic details. Now, in the New Testament, John the Apostle is given the most extensive revelation of any New Testament figures, and the prophet Daniel has that honor in the Old Testament. Now, his prophecy of the 70 weeks is the backbone of all other end-time prophecies in the Bible. Now, as I said, I'll talk about it next week. Now, this true story is told about a European rabbi by the name of Leopold Kahn, who studied the prophecy of the 70 weeks, that is this chapter, and he came to the conclusion that the Messiah had already come because his coming was to be before the destruction that he knew took place in AD 70. So one day he approached an older rabbi and asked him, "Where is the Messiah?" The older rabbi didn't know, and he thought perhaps in New York City. So the rabbi sold almost everything he owned and he went to New York City looking for the Messiah. And one night he walked past the door of a gospel mission. He heard singing and he went in and he heard a gospel message. That night, Rabbi Leopold Kahn received Jesus Christ as his Savior and Messiah. Now, soon after that, he started the first outreach of what was to become the American Board of Missions for Jews. It started because a man read the prophecy of the 70 weeks in this passage, and he realized that it taught that Jesus was the Messiah and he had already come. Now, most scholars believe that Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 to 27 in particular, is the backbone of all prophecy. Now, it is the skeletal outline into which all prophetic events fit. Matthew chapter 24 and 25 and the book of Revelation would be difficult to understand without this passage in the Bible. Now, at this point in time, 69/70 of the prophecy has been fulfilled. But the prophecy was given years before it was fulfilled. We will be able to look back at history and trace the literal, accurate, detailed fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy and look into the future to the 70th week, which is to be fulfilled. It will give us confidence, my friends, to believe that what God has done in the first part of the prophecy, he will surely do in the last part, and we may be that audience. This prophecy is the answer to Daniel's prayer in the first 19 verses of Daniel chapter 9, which we were studying for the last 2 weeks. Now, he says that in the midst of his praying, God spoke to him. Daniel uses 4 words to describe his praying. He says, "While I was speaking," then he says, "While I was praying," and then again, "While I was confessing my sin," and then he says, "While I was presenting my supplication." During that time, Gabriel, the archangel, comes. In verse 21, we discover Daniel praying at a very, very specific time. The angel who came to answer his prayer came about the time of the evening offering, it says. Now, in the Jewish religion, the time of the evening offering was 3 o'clock in the afternoon. That was when the sacrifice was offered. The time of the evening offering, this was a special time of the day. If you look at Exodus 12:6, you'll find that Moses offered the Passover lamb in this time. And then if you look at Matthew 27:45, Jesus was crucified. Daniel was in prayer at that special time, 3 o'clock. In the Jewish religious calendar, and what overwhelms me personally is that Daniel had been away from Jerusalem for 70 or so long years, and he had been away from the temple, away from the priests, away from any semblance of their organized religion. Yet at 3 o'clock in Babylon, Daniel was praying, remembering that special time in his homeland. At the very moment of Daniel's prayer, he got his answer. Verse 21 says, "While I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision," that is in chapter 8, verse 16, "came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice." Now, this dramatic answer to prayer came even as Daniel prayed. Now, Jesus said in Matthew 6 and verse 8, "Your Father knows what you need before you ask Him." But whenever there seems to be a delay in answer to prayer, there is a reason for the delay. But when it is right on schedule to do it, God will answer your prayer immediately. Let me repeat that again. Whenever there seems to be a delay in answer to your prayer, there is a reason for that delay. But when it is right on schedule to do it, God will answer your prayer immediately. Sometimes God answers prayer even before we pray. And I think you have those experiences. If you read Isaiah 65:24, it says, "It shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer, and while they are still speaking, I will hear." Now, Dr. Gablian says that one day he recited Daniel's prayer in Hebrew, and it took him about 3 minutes. So he computed that from the time Daniel began to pray, which was when we are told the angel began to fly, to the end of the prayer took 3 minutes. The angel made an all-time speed record by coming from heaven to earth in 3 minutes. No wonder the scripture says that Gabriel came in a swift flight. Now, this is one of the few places in the Bible where we are told that angels fly. The name Gabriel, of course, means God is my strength. Now, angels are not omnipresent. They can't be everywhere at once like God. Angels are spirit beings. You'll read about that in Hebrews 1:14. And they can also assume the human form whenever they feel necessary. One example is in Luke 24 and verse 4. Now, they have to go from some place to somewhere. They have to move about in space. When you come down to verse 22, we find that it says, "Gabriel instructed Daniel, 'Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding.'" Now, in his prayer, Daniel didn't ask for understanding. His prayer demonstrated that his heart was close to God's heart. So as a friend, God revealed many things to Daniel. Daniel studied the passage in Jeremiah, but still didn't understand much. In this case, understanding came more through prayer. For Daniel, in this case, understanding came more through prayer. It was Charles Spurgeon who said, "All students of the word will tell you that when the hammers of learning and biblical criticism have failed to break open a flinty text, oftentimes prayer has done it, and nuggets of gold have been found concealed therein." To every student of the word of God who would become a well-instructed scribe, we would say, with all the means which you employ, with all your searchings of the commentaries, with all your diggings into the original, with all your researches among learned divines, mingle much fervent prayer. Now, Daniel illustrated that principle that when we seek God diligently in His word, we often receive even more than we ask for. As Daniel was praying, God told Gabriel, "I want you to go and give Daniel information, and I want you to go now." And in verse 23, Gabriel tells Daniel, "As soon as you began to pray, an answer was given." In other words, Gabriel tells Daniel, at the beginning of your supplications, the command went out. And Gabriel flew swiftly to Daniel and said, "I've got something to tell you." Now, as Gabriel begins to explain the prophecy to Daniel, he says by way of introduction that he is going to tell Daniel these things because Daniel is highly esteemed, or in some versions, greatly beloved. Both Daniel and the Apostle John of the New Testament were noted for their love relationship with God. In John 13:23, one of them, it says, the disciple whom Jesus loved, referring to John in a moral sense, was reclining next to him. Both Daniel and John were also noted for receiving amazing prophetic messages. The greatest source of prophetic information in the New Testament is the Apostle John. In the Old Testament, most would agree that it would be Daniel. Now these two, Daniel and John the Apostle, are alike in that they are both greatly beloved by God. Many scholars think the secret of God's giving to Daniel and John the special privilege of being the bearers of prophetic revelation lies in their unusual obedience to him. Now, before we get into how this prophecy is fulfilled, we need to learn some terms and understand how it all fits together. Now, the first thing we run into is in verse 24 in the actual prophecy is this. 77s are decreed, determined for your people. The word for week in the Old Testament actually means seven. The verse actually begins by saying 77, verse 24, 77 are determined. Now it is a kind of like our word dozen. If we said 70 dozen are determined, we wouldn't know exactly what the dozen were. Now this 77s is referring of years here. In Leviticus, we see the number 7 associated with years, not days. Leviticus 25 in verse 3 and 4 says, 6 years you shall sow your field, and 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather its fruit. But in the seventh year, there shall be a Sabbath of solemn rest for the land, a Sabbath to the Lord. You shall neither sow your field nor prune your vineyard. Here is a seven associated with years, the Sabbath year. We know about the Sabbath day. Now here in Leviticus, we are reading and it teaches us about the Sabbath year. Now when you come down to Leviticus 25 verse 8 and 9, it talks about the 7 times 7 years. And then that 50th year referring to the Jubilee year. In the Old Testament, the word seven was often used to describe not a week of days as we understand it, but a week of years. So it was very much part of their very culture. What Daniel was thinking of was not days out here. He was thinking in terms of years. So back in Daniel chapter 9 verse 2, he says, I, Daniel, understood from the scriptures according to the word of the Lord given to Jeremiah the prophet that the desolation of Jerusalem would last 70 years. Daniel was thinking about years and not days. Now Daniel's mind was also on the end of the captivity which his people were already involved in. Now the reason the Jews were in captivity was not just because of their disobedience and apostasy, but they were to remain captives until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths. Now where is this little bit of information that the people had defaulted on their obedience about the Sabbath year, and therefore the 70 years captivity was also for that? It's in 2 Chronicles chapter 36 and verse 20 and 21. It says this, God carried into exile to Babylon the remnant who escaped from the sword, and they became servants to Nebuchadnezzar and his sons until the kingdom of Persia came to power. The land enjoyed its Sabbath rests all the time of its desolation. It rested until the 70 years were completed in fulfillment of the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah. So God had told the people he wanted 1 year out of seven, but the Jewish people wouldn't give it to him. So God took it. While they were captive in Babylon, the land back around Jerusalem was getting caught up on the Sabbath that belonged to God but weren't given to him all the while. A principle that comes out of the study is that if you don't give God what he owns and what he has determined you to give him, then he'll take it at some point of time because he is a God of justice. Now we may think we are getting by in not giving what belongs to God in terms of our talents and tithes and time. But if we did the calculations from God's viewpoint, we might discover that God is already getting it back. If not now, then in some time. So the point here is that we just don't have the privilege of giving it to him. It is our duty which we must oblige through obedience. Otherwise, we are inviting his discipline needlessly. Okay, coming to verse 24 about the 77s. 70 times 7 equals 490 years. So the prophecy is talking about 490 years that are determined or cut out of the calendar. Throughout the whole book of Daniel, we have been talking about how God is going to work through the Gentile rulers. But God has cut out 490 years that belong to the Jews. Now he shows how his program will work in that period of time. Now in the Old Testament, a year was not made up of 365 days. The prophetic year was 360 days, as seen in the story of Noah and in the prophecies in Daniel and Revelation. What happened to the other 5 days of the year? Just like we don't have a perfect calendar even today and have to put in a leap year, they had a kind of a leap year too, but it was just a bigger leap than ours. The second part of verse 24, it says, so what will be accomplished in the 70 weeks or the 77s? I would like to read verse 24 once again for you. It says, 77s are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression. That is the first thing, to put an end to sin, the second thing, and then to atone for wickedness, the third thing, to bring in everlasting righteousness, which is the fourth, and then to seal up vision, fifth, and finally, the sixth one is to prophesy and to anoint the most holy. So the first part which will be accomplished in those 70 weeks or this 490 years, as we may say, is to finish the transgression. Now this says that transgression itself will be finished. Taken literally, this means establishing an entirely new order on earth with an end to man's rebellion against God. We find that fulfillment in Christ's coming. We'll talk about that next week. The second thing which was accomplished in those 490 years, which is past now, is to put an end to sin. Now, taking these words at face value, this means not only the end of the guilt of sin, but an end of sin itself. It means to seal up or to restrain sins. This looks to a new redeemed world through the cross of Christ, where sin has no power over a believer. The third thing that was accomplished in that 490 years is to atone for wickedness. You see, man's iniquity must be reconciled to God's justice and God's holiness. Now, this work was clearly accomplished on the cross of Jesus Christ. Fourth, to bring in everlasting righteousness. One might take this in an individual sense, but there have always been righteous individuals. Now, taking the statement at face value, this means a new order of society brought in by the Messiah, a society which was righteous in their acts and righteous or supposed to be supposed to continue to be righteous. Now, the fifth thing that we see around here, which was accomplished in that 490 years, was to seal up vision and prophecy. Now, this speaks of both the ending and fulfillment of prophecy, concluding the final stage of human history and culminating with the reign of the Son of God. And finally, the sixth thing was to anoint the Most Holy. Taken at its simple literal meaning, this refers to a place, not a person. So there is a Most Holy place, the Most Holy place for the temple that will be anointed and blessed. So taken as a whole, Gabriel made a remarkable announcement to Daniel. He told him that each of these six amazing things would happen within the period of 70 weeks, that is within 490 years from then. So looking back in history, we can only say that these things are already fulfilled within that time frame of 490 years. And in verse 25, we see the course and the dividing of those 70 weeks. It says, from the issuing of the decree, restore and rebuild Jerusalem. If you look at verse 25, you'll read this. From the issuing of the decree, restore and rebuild Jerusalem. So here Gabriel revealed to Daniel the starting point for the 70 weeks prophecy. There was a command, you see, to restore and build Jerusalem in history that started this specific period of time. And the second part of that verse, it says, until the anointed one, the ruler comes, there will be 77s and 62 sevens. Gabriel's message to Daniel was very simple and striking. 483 years, that is 69 units of 7 years, would pass from the time of the command recorded that we read in Nehemiah chapter 2 verses 1 to 8 until the appearance of Messiah the Prince. We find this command recorded in Nehemiah chapter 2 verses 1 to 8 where the permission to rebuild the walls and the temple were given at the time of Artaxerxes. You see, some say the 483 years were completed at the time of Jesus' birth. There is little chronological support for this date. We'll talk about this much in detail next week because this section takes a whole lot of session. In verse 26, we read about what happens after the first 69 weeks, that is after 483 years. And it says, after the 62 weeks, the anointed shall be cut off and will have nothing. The biblical term cut off is sometimes used to describe execution. We read that in Genesis 9:11 and Exodus 31:14. Gabriel told Daniel that the anointed, who is none other than the Messiah, will be cut off for the sake of others, not for himself. Now, this verse is prophesying about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ almost 500 years before. The phrase cut off is a poignant description of Jesus' earthly life up to and including the cross. Now, he was born in another man's stable, cradled in another man's manger with nowhere to lay his head during his life on earth, and he was buried in another man's tomb after dying on a cursed cross. The Christ of God and the friend of the friendless was indeed cut off and had nothing. Now, in the second part of verse 26, we read about the people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. After the Messiah was cut off, Jerusalem and her temple would be destroyed again by an overwhelming army with a flood. Most Bible scholars and commentators agreed that this part of the verse was fulfilled in the Roman destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. The people of the prince who is to come shall destroy, it says. You see, the destroying army is made up of the people of the prince who is to come. And this coming prince is described more in detail in verse 27 of this chapter. Verse 27, it says, he will confirm a covenant. Now, the he that is referred to by Gabriel described is the prince who is to come, mentioned in the previous verse 26. Now, if we know that the prince's people destroyed Jerusalem in AD 70, then we know this coming prince has his ancestral roots in the soil of the ancient Roman Empire. Therefore, the prince who is to come will in some way be an heir to the Romans, even as the final world government is an heir to the Roman Empire, which we studied in Daniel chapter 7. More on this next week. So what was God trying to tell Daniel in the prophecy? First, that it is a prophecy concerning the Jewish people. God talked to Daniel about how the Gentile rulers were going to follow one after the other, and Daniel is probably wondering how the Jews fit into it. He has already asked God to help him understand what will happen after they have been brought back out of captivity. Now, God is saying to Daniel with this prophecy, I am not finished with your people yet. My plan for you is still in the book. I want you to see how my plan for you in fits in this with my plan for the Gentiles. So then God lays out for Daniel the whole landscape of his future program for Israel. Many have forgotten today that God's plan for the Jews has never been declined or halted. He still has a plan. We just happen to be living in the parenthesis. God's program for the Jews is 490 years. Whenever he is not dealing with them, he stops the clock. Where are we today is the question. In a little stopping off place, God wanted to deal with the Jews. He sent his son and he offered himself to his people. John 1:11-12 says, he came to his own and his own did not receive him, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. We are parenthesis in that phrase. When Israel rejected Jesus as their Messiah, he turned to the Gentiles and he put aside his plan for the Jews. Now, God has put the Jews on the sideline now as a nation. 69 of the 70 weeks have been fulfilled, my dear friends. We may as well be in the end of the parenthetic section, and pretty soon the rapture is going to come. And then the great tribulation that we know as the 70th week will be ushered in with Antichrist in the lead role, which is talked about in verse 27 as him being the prince. So the prophecy can be outlined in this way. Verse 24 is the entire scope of the whole prophecy, and it is like a summary statement. In verse 25, we have the information about the first 69 weeks of Daniel's 70 weeks. And in verse 26, we understand the parenthesis we are right now. And then finally, in verse 27, deals with all of the information of the 70th week. Daniel just asked God to tell him what was going to happen to the Jews in Babylon. I wonder if Daniel really knew what he was going to get into when he prayed that prayer. He just wanted to know when the 70 years of captivity were going to be over, and God said, Daniel, because of the kind of a person you are and because of your walk with me in righteousness and obedience, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do for you and your people as long as you are on the face of this earth. Daniel prayed righteously, and God gave him not only what he asked for, but he gave him abundantly more. I think God is still doing that today. Often when we go to God and ask him for something, he not only gives us what we ask for, but much more. Just like Solomon, who asked the Lord for wisdom, God gave him wisdom, all right, and he added to Solomon's wisdom fame and honor and wealth and a lot of things that Solomon didn't ask for. Many Jews are still waiting for the Messiah to come the first time. But Jesus has already come. We are not looking for the Messiah today. We are looking for his secret return in the rapture. As surely as he came the first time, he is going to come again. And this time when he comes around, we better be found ready, because he is not asking for a manger this time, but he is offering heaven. One ancient rabbi said, "Let the bones of those who reckon the times tremble in fear. Let the bones of those who calculate the times tremble in fear." But we who are Christians answer in glad response, "Let the hearts of those who calculate the times rejoice." Jesus has already come. Let us be among those who love his appearing. So much for today. I'll get into the details of this passage concerning its fulfillment and its future fulfillment next week, same time, in Virtual Bible Study Session 22.